I don't know, international, worldwide strategic approach of Leo Burnett, and then I'm going to go into a very specific example that might be relevant for your markets as well as Romania, where this example actually happened. And I'll show you all the good things and all the bad things we've done for one client for the past 8 years. I'll show you everything we've done. A lot of it is bad. Some of it I think is good. And maybe together we could draw some conclusions to that. Okay. This is the Leo Burnett worldwide mission. We create ideas that inspire enduring belief. Right? And basically, like any mission, vision, statement, has a story of its own. All seven words in this statement have their own meaning and so on. But what's probably different than any other network and any other agency is the part with the enduring belief. Everybody says we're dealing in ideas, right? But Leo Burnett is talking about enduring belief. Well, this thing with the belief, I'd like to stretch out a little bit, okay? Talk a little bit about the power of believing in a brand, the power of belief. As the dictionary has it, belief is unconditionally accepting something as being real or true. This is what belief is in the dictionary. And here are some brands that we think managed to do that. Okay. I don't know other company, if I look at the last one, of the Harley Davidson, I don't know other company whose name is tattooed on people's skin. You know. Disney, Apple, Body Shop, Virgin, Nike, and there could be many many more brands that I think inspire belief in many different ways, right? Using advertising or not. So how do we define a believer? Well, believers are not just bias. It's not just loyal bias. It's not only about purchasing behavior. Because if you do a promotion, if you do a price cut, you can bribe the consumer to buy you loyally for a period. Okay? And these brands that I showed you earlier, they don't really do that, and they don't really need that. So the believer is defined as a person who has both a loyal purchasing behavior, so he buys you a lot, but he also loves you. Okay? Very simply put, a believer is a person who buys you and who loves you. Okay? These are supposed to be pluses and a plus and an equal. I don't know why it looks like that. So, strong purchasing behavior and affinity towards the brand. So, buying and loving gives you brand belief. Very shortly, this is special for my friend Giovanni, who we quarreled over this. We argued over this 2 nights ago, and I was drawing the same thing on a napkin in a bar. I hope here is a little bit clearer, right? Okay, on these two axes that define, on the horizontal that define brand behavior, how often do you buy it? Okay, and on the vertical, it says, how much do you love me or not? Of course, your whole universe of consumers, of your brand consumers could be, of a target group, could be defined in the upper corner. Where it says believers is people who love me and buy me. Of course, these are drawn equal, but they are not equal. You have like 3% believers, and you might have 80% non-buyers, right? Non-believers. The wanna believers are the people who love me but don't buy me, and they could love a brand but don't buy a brand, for instance, because it's too expensive. Ferrari. Okay, let's take Ferrari. I think they have a lot of wanna believers. They have a lot of people that love Ferrari that feel for Michael Schumacher, but not. They don't quite buy Ferrari, all those people, right? On the other hand, we have the guys that buy me but don't love me. It's housewives and detergents, okay? They buy detergents because they need to wash their clothes. Do you believe that any woman loves a detergent brand? I don't think so. No. And then there's the non-believers, people that don't buy me, that don't love me, and you don't want to spend $1 for these people. You don't want to spend 1 hour thinking, how do I get non-believers to buy it? The most efficient way is to make your wanna believers, the people who love you, to make them buy it, and the people who buy it, make them love you. And this is probably, for the wanna believers, probably you need to do I don't know, maybe they don't buy it because you're not in their market, you're not in their neighborhood, maybe you're too expensive and so on. So there are ways to tackle this and to make them buy it. Of course, people who buy it but don't love you, probably communication plays an important role here, and you might make them love it. I don't know, hard figures saying why belief pays and why we should try to make people buy us and love us. Believers don't leave your brand. These are people who live. This is a study, Brandstock, it's a study done by Leo Burnett in the United States on over 200 and something brands over some years. And apparently, out of people annually leaving the brand, the people who have a strong belief, the way we define it, that love you and buy me, are 1.5%. Okay? The people with weak belief leave much easier your brand. In terms of volume contribution, okay, even if you have 2.5% of your target group are your believers, what they do is they buy 32% of your volume. So the index, meaning how much more they buy compared to how many they are, is the best. And of course, it goes down the scale. It goes worse and worse. And this is, I believe, is the last one on believers. Believers in a brand are less sensitive and less driven by price. Actually, people that believe in the brand, and we have this fight with Giovanni, actually this is the fight. My personal belief is that people who believe in a brand, they are willing to pay more for the brand because this is the way that they feel they can respect the brand. Mm-hmm. If the brand is cheap, I don't think that they wait for the sales season to buy the brand. When a new model of Nike comes out, the people who love the brand Nike go and buy it on this premium price. They don't wait six months later to buy it at 20%, you know, or at half price reductions. People who love that brand, it's not necessarily the case. There might be a lot of people who don't love that brand in Japan. So they wait for the price. Also, they advocate the brand and they recruit more believers. People talk very nicely about their brand and think about Harley Davidson, if you want. And also, you can calculate. You can actually make a calculation, seeing how many believers get into the brand yearly and how many believers leave the brand annually. And then you will basically very accurately predict the future of your brand. If more people are coming into the brand, probably you'll be better next year than if people are leaving your brand. And then the question is, how do you turn a buyer into a believer? Well. The recipe says, can I have some water here? Voda? Okay, to build belief, you need to do four things. First thing, and this is true for any brand, and how many people are here from agencies? Any clients? Oh, two clients. This is fun. The rest is what? Passionate people, students. Yeah? Okay. I think that this presentation talks both to agency people and to clients as well. So, if you want to build belief, you need to do four things. And the first thing to do, and I'd like everybody, you know, to think about your own market and think if you do have in your own market any brand that does these four steps. The first is find the brand truth. Okay. What's a brand truth? It's something that is very relevant for the brand. Something. What do you want to say about your brand? Okay. What is your brand about? It should be one thing, not three things, not seven things, not two pages of the brief. One thing. Which is the safest car in the world? Volvo, right? Because they said this for 20 years. It's not anymore. It's not anymore true. But people believe that. Which is the most masculine cigarette in the world? Marlboro, right? We don't think you have any questions there. Why? Because they said it. There was one thing that they said over 50 years. So find a brand truth that is relevant for your brand, but very, very, very important, it's relevant also for the consumer. Nobody gives a shit that you have, in your beer, you have the best hops or the best, nobody gives a shit about that. You might be very proud as a producer that you have the best hops, but if nobody cares about that, this is not your brand truth, or it shouldn't be your brand truth. So find something that is true both to the brand and relevant to the consumer. It can be real, or it can be simply perceived. Okay? We work in this business. Perception is reality. It can be real, it can be tangible, it can be physical, it can be in the product, but it can be complete fantasy. Okay? Do you think that the cigarette, the Marlboro cigarette, has anything in it that makes it more masculine than other cigarettes? I don't think that it has to do with the tobacco, it doesn't have to do with the filter, it doesn't have to do with the packaging. Okay? What it has to do with is an image that they built. But now, nobody questions that Marlboro is the most masculine cigarette. Which is the most masculine motorcycle? Harley Davidson. Nothing, I keep saying that, you know. Harley Davidson doesn't have like two special things to put your balls in. Okay? It's not nothing to do with the product. Nothing to do with the product, it's purely perception. So don't. If you think it's just perceived, don't say it has to be real. It doesn't necessarily have to be real. And the brand truth. Another thing about the brand truth: it can come from attributes or from values. I will just quickly explain what I mean. Attributes are things within the product. It can come from physical qualities of the product, but it can come from values. Values is what the product does for you. It's like, for instance, Volvo can claim the safest car. It could be, attributes could be, we have the 55 airbags, we have the thickest, whatever, bodywork, we have steel bars and doors, but it can be values, meaning we keep your family safe. We are the number one choice of people, of young parents. The minute you give, and actually this is true about Volvo, the first choice, the first car you think about when you have a new baby is, I'll buy a Volvo. Okay, now I need to be safe. Until then, okay, I need to, Alfa Romeo. I have a kid, oh, Volvo. Or Nissan, or whatever, big cars. Yeah. So it can come both from attributes or values. Crucial, it should be differentiating and ownable. It should be only yours, and it should be different from anybody else in the category. I've seen, as being part of the jury this year, I've seen a lot of work in this festival. I don't know if I've seen everything that's on the market. Probably people sent in the best work. But I don't think I found, I don't remember right now, you know, like top of mind, any work that talked for me about a brand really, really differentiating. All the beers were the same. All the alcohol was pretty much the same. All the, I don't know, telecom was crap, basically. I don't know, how many telecom operators do you have? How many mobile phone operators do you have in Ukraine? Five. What's Kyiv Star? What does it stand for? What was the difference between Kyiv Star and there's one with a U, whatever? No, except the owner. What was the difference? What was their position? How are they different? I didn't perceive it from their work, from the work that I've seen. I didn't get any difference. You should be different if you want to build a brand. Second thing you need to do once you establish your brand truth is translating it into a brand idea. Okay. Give it a human form. Because a brand idea brings long-term value to the brand, and this is the inspiration for communication. And in a second, I'll give you some examples so you get it better. The brand idea should be rooted, should be based on the brand truth. Okay. Should be simple, should be clear. Should both make strategic sense, but also be creative. Should be credible, should be relevant, and should have potential to inspire both the mind and the heart of the believers. If I want people to buy me and to love me, I have to talk both to the rational side of the brain, but I also have to talk about to the emotional side of the brain. Right? And the definition is, the brand idea is a simple inspiring statement of simply what we want people to believe about the brand. I'll go quickly through this. Why, how do you know that the brand idea is good or not? It must inspire and evoke a deep resonance in people. People, when they see it, should say, yeah, we think like that. You know, it should be insightful. And it must have the ring of truth. It must you know, smell like truth. It shouldn't be necessarily provable demo PNG kind of detergent demo or hard data behind it, but it should smell of truth. Must turn the familiar into unexpected, must be able to attract people that think in the same way and have that wow effect. Okay. Once you have this brand idea, and I will get it, we'll get back to it pretty quickly. Okay. The third thing you need to do is communicate that idea with integrity. And when you say integrity, this means always the same thing. If you want to talk about masculinity with Marlboro, always be masculine. Always talk in everything you do. Say the same thing, even in under new forms or expressions. I'll give you the example of Nike, a brand that is very, very, whatever, dear to me. They said the same, you know, you can do it, just do it. First by showing athletes like Michael Jordan, now they say it by showing urban sports like tag or musical chairs. But the idea is exactly the same, it's just do it. Doesn't matter the form that they say it in. And also, when we talk about integrity, we don't talk necessarily about advertising. We talk, you should say the same thing, you should communicate the same brand idea in any place, in any way, in wherever the brand gets in contact with its believers. Meaning, we do this, we don't talk only about communication, about advertising, we talk about packaging, we talk about promotions, we talk about launching new extensions of the brand. For instance, how masculine do you think is the cowboy who smokes Marlboro Menthol? For me, it's kind of the girlfriend of the other cowboys. Okay, so this for me, I can see the market opportunity to be in the segment, in the mental segment, but I think it's wrong for the brand to do this. Okay. This is, you know, when we say, what if Harley Davidson will come and put out bicycles? Well, it's a huge market. It's a lot of teenagers. We should expand to the youngsters. Let's do bicycles. Porsche Cayenne. Why do you do Porsche Cayenne? Porsche is small, it's low, it's fast, it's a sports car. Why do you do a SUV out of that? BMW X5. Why do you do it? Because they're greedy, this is why. Because they want more money. But they hurt the brand. I think they're wrong. And then the last thing you need to do, so you find a brand truth, you express it in a brand idea, you communicate it with integrity, and you have to communicate it with charisma. Yeah. People need to be seduced. People need to, you know, whenever I'm in front of TV and I'm watching a movie, because for me, commercials are like, and I'm sure in this market as well, commercials are like small movies. They have a lot of entertainment value. If they're good, of course. Or people expect it to be entertaining. If you see a bad movie, it's the same as seeing a bad commercial. You don't want to see a bad movie. You want them, the guys inside the TV, you know, to think about you and treat you like a clever guy and seduce you, you know, try to charm you somehow. You must create aspiration, and this doesn't, for me, it doesn't necessarily mean that you need only to advertise premium products. Aspiration is not about status. Necessarily. Aspiration could be, as I told you about other values like masculinity. We have a newspaper in Romania that says, or The Economist, for instance, in England, that says our readers are smarter than the other readers. This is a different kind of aspiration. They don't say buy this because then you look like a successful and rich guy, like all news or business newspapers say. They say our readers are smarter than their readers. Okay? They create aspiration. this is hard for clients. This is really hard for clients, okay, respecting the consumer intelligence. I work for P&G a lot. So I know this is a tough one with them. If you talk to the lowest denominator, if you talk so that the stupidest guy will understand you, only the stupidest guy will understand you. It's only him that one. The other guys will say, "I'm not stupid. Why do you talk to me like that?" And quite on the contrary, if you think he's an intelligent guy and you leave half of the story to happen in his head, then he says, "Well, how do you react when you're at a party or whatever and somebody comes to you and says, 'I think you're really a smart person. I think you're pretty intelligent.' Okay, do you want to sleep with it? Want me to sleep with it? What is your normal reaction? Okay, if somebody calls you, you're smart, you're clever, right? So we should do this without communication. We should make people respect themselves and feel that we respect their intelligence. Actually, usually what we hear from clients is never overestimate the intelligence of the consumer. I always heard that. Or if they're nice and politically correct, like Procter & Gamble, they say never underestimate the intelligence of the consumer. Okay. Well, IKEA, and I think, to my knowledge, IKEA is the only worldwide furniture brand. I don't think that anybody else knows a second worldwide furniture brand. People from Australia to, I don't know, whatever, Madagascar. They know IKEA. They don't know any other furniture brand. And in their brand book, these guys from IKEA have this statement: always overestimate the intelligence of the consumer. And this is how they do their advertising. This is how they do even their product, if you think about it. Because a lot of it is do-it-yourself. You take it and you assemble it at home. So these guys say, my consumer is very, very smart. He's smarter than I think he is. Ogilvy said it: with the consumer is not a moron, he's your wife, okay? Or she, whatever, she's your wife. But this one is like in the Bible, in the IKEA Bible. Always think they're smarter than they are. This is why they do advertising the way they do. This is why they did the lamp. And also, what I was talking earlier, don't forget to talk to the right brain hemisphere too. Okay? Talk to their emotions as well. Don't give them only hard figures. Or if your brand truth is very rational and you have very strong data to support it with, doesn't matter. Say it in a nice way. Say it in a way that attracts. Say it in a way that pleases. This is what will give you the tell me more effect. People want to hear more about your brand. If your brand is communicated with charisma, okay, tell me more. When is the next one coming? When is the next? Who knows the Real American Heroes campaign for Budweiser? Or the Wazak? You know Wazak? How was everybody waiting for the next commercial? Oh, and so the third one. Is there any new one? Let's go on the site and check it out. This is what happens when you talk with charisma. Graphically, very simple. Giovanni, even you, man. If you want to inspire enduring belief, remember my statement in the Leo Burnett mission in the beginning, that we create ideas that inspire enduring belief. If you want to inspire enduring belief, what you need to do is find a brand truth, translate it in a brand idea. If you want it to be enduring, then say it with integrity. If you want it to be inspirational, say it with charisma. Basically, this is the whole model that Leo Burnett works with worldwide. Find a brand truth, translate it into a brand idea, say it with charisma, say it with integrity, not integritat. This one I forgot to. I forgot to translate that. Sorry. The truth about Nike, the way we define it, it's actually what they want to be is a sports religion. They build heroes like any religion. They build, icons. They say we'll just do it. I think they did it with a lot of integrity over the last, 20 years or so. And charisma, look at the goal lines. Marlboro, if Marlboro was, okay, if the brand truth of Marlboro is masculine cigarette, is the most masculine cigarette, the brand idea for Marlboro was Marlboro Man, was the cowboy, okay, which later developed into the whole Marlboro country. This is the brand idea. The truth is masculine. How do we express it? expressing the cowboy in the world of cowboys. And they did it, except Marlboro Menthol. They did it with a lot of integrity, and they did it, I think they did it with a lot of charisma. This is why they are the only cigarette, except for being the best-selling cigarette in the world, it's the only cigarette in the Interbrand, top of most valuable brand. It's the only cigarette which is in that top. Talking about integrity, you know, right? Now, who's from Leo Burnett here? Who works on Philip Morris? Only one guy. I'll fire the rest. I see all this. I can imagine what happened to the cowboy. You know? Imagine in the 60s, okay? Or in the 70s. Okay? Hippie. Everybody was hippie, flower power. Imagine the agency talking to the client. Man, forget the cowboy. Hippie. Hippie is what's cool today. What do you mean cowboy? Hippie, man. In the 80s, disco. Why are you coming with the cowboy? Okay. Disco, man. This is what's cool today. Youngsters want disco. They don't want cowboys. Cowboys are dead 100 years ago. Imagine in the 90s, rap, whatever. Imagine what's happening today. And we have this fight with the client all the time. Some young creative, smartass, comes and says, forget the cowboy, man. Who gives a shit about the cowboy in 2005? Matrix, man. Matrix is the metrosexuals. This is what's cool to do. Why do you come with the cowboy? Fortunately, there is, I think that the contract with the cowboy was signed with the blood. You cannot break that contract. So, fortunately, somebody is wise enough to fire these guys whenever they come with these ideas. Change the fucking cowboy. Let's do Matrix. Every now and then they still do, you know, that like Mixtronica and Partisan. Disney, which is the brand, what do you think is the brand truth of Disney? Why they are so successful? What's Disney about? As a studio, as movies, as Disney Worlds and so on. Mickey Mouse? I don't think it's the Mickey Mouse is the brand truth. What's the reason? Why are they so successful? Fairy tales, I would agree, it's fairy tales. Let me give you another. Even if it's not about Disney, you know which was the most sold book after the Bible? No, Harry Potter. Yeah, Harry Potter. Do you know Harry Potter?
Yeah.
At least you've seen the movie. I don't know if you've read the books. Who got 11 Oscar awards last year?
Lord of the Rings.
Huh? What does this tell you? Why is Disney successful? Because people love stories, man. People love stories and fairy tales. Because what Disney says is that we're always changing. It doesn't matter the age, we love stories. This is why we buy Harry Potter. This is why we wait and we crowd the halls. Every time a new Harry Potter movie comes, and it's not kids that 8-year-olds. It's me. I'm going to every Harry Potter. I'm on the waiting list for Harry Potter 6 to get the book from England. I get. If you get on the site and you join the fan club of Harry Potter, you get an owl. You know the owls that they get in Hogwarts. There is these birds coming and bringing in letters, and in the story, I get one. And I'm 37 years old, but I get one every birthday. I get one from the writer. You know, an email, a birthday owl from J.K. Rowling for Bobo. I feel very good when I receive that out. And the way they expressed it, the brand idea is magic happens. It's also their slogan, is magic happens. And this is what they do. This is why it doesn't matter how well it will sell, how much money it will... talking about Disney's integrity, okay? It doesn't matter how much money it will make. The Disney studios will never make Terminator 3 or 4. Never. It doesn't matter, it will sell like hell. Matrix 5, it will never come from Disney. In their amusement parks, in Disney World, you will never see, you know, people, I don't know, killing each other. There will never be a Disney karate school. Okay? And I think they do it with a lot of charisma as well. So this is our brand belief system. Brand through brand identity, integrity, and charisma. Let's show. Now let's go to some and see some work that we did. Back in Romania, we have this soft drink called Prigat. It's a non-carbonated soft drink. It's the company is run by some Israeli guys, but the brand is Romanian, so it's not an international brand. Prigat. And back in 1997, when I joined Leo Burnett, they also came to us and say, "Okay, we want to launch Nectar." I'm sure you know what Nectar is. We want to launch Nectar. Let's have a commercial. Okay. The only thing that they had at the time was a slogan which said "natural choice." Okay, natural choice. Let's make a commercial, and you'll see the first one of the worst commercials we've ever did. I'm happy to show it to you guys. And this is it. What's with the sound?
În fiecare zi, acest om face același lucru.
Every day this guy does the same things.
Știe că este
like anybody else.
System.
He knows he's just a will in the system.
Și-ar dori să poată alege.
But he would love to choose.
Însă, de obicei,
but usually other people make choices.
Alege ce e mai bun. Noul Nectar, alegerea naturală de la Brigat.
The natural choice from Brigat. So every day he would love to make his choices. He does it. Every day he does the same things. He would love to have a choice, but usually other people do the choices for him. So choose Brigat, the natural choice. Balloon, I can tell you, because I think it's the only Romanian shooting with a balloon. We went 3 times to the mountains to lift the fucking balloon. Once it got lost, and then does anybody know shit about ballooning? You can, you know, they look so big and tough. You can get it up if the wind blows like this. You can lift it up. So it has to be completely still. Whatever. So this is the commercial with which we launched Prigat. The brand truth. We didn't know the shit about brand truth and stuff, but now retro thinking. The brand truth was natural. What they wanted to say is, we're natural. Man. This is natural. It's not the Coca-Cola or Pepsi-Cola. They're also, by the way, the bottles of Pepsi-Cola. It's not the thing that you do, like chemistry and bubbles and stuff. This is natural. It comes from fruits and so on. And then the brand idea was the natural choice. This is the way it was expressed. Natural choice. Well, the natural choice had two... First of all, it wasn't very... I think it had two faults. First of all, it wasn't very, very inspiring. Second, I think it's misleading, because natural choice for the creative. Remember I told you that a good idea should inspire good creative work, you know, should inspire the creatives. And for me, the natural choice had this fault that you're tempted as a creative not to talk about natural, like in the fruit, you're tempted to talk about the choice. And about natural choice as in terms of the normal choice, the choice that comes easy, you know. This is the understanding of natural that would you feel has more potential than talking about natural, like fruits and stuff. And you go natural choice, you know, the first choice. And probably the link to the product will be just in words, just a play on words and not a real link. This is what we did next. Some of it, and this is again a mistake that agencies do. They have the same, the company in Israel, and every now and then they come with a commercial from Israel and say, we put this on it. See, we have an Israeli commercial, put it on air. You know, it doesn't matter if it's done on a completely different brand idea, completely different strategy, put it on air. And we would take it, adapt it, and put it on air. So this was the second commercial. Thank you. okay, artificial things like the wig, like the false teeth, whatever, Viagra and so on, as opposed to the natural thing, which is Prigat, of course. Integrity between the two, I would say that, except the slogan at the end. I don't see how, you know, like the guy that is in the office and suddenly you feel liberated when you drink something natural, has anything to do with party over, party around the pool. Everything is artificial except this one. I don't think we had a lot of integrity with these two. This was back in 97, 98. Right? Charisma, debatable. And then, let me see if this is the one that I know. Yeah. Check this out. The first live TV show comes in on the Romanian television, like the ones, like the Big Brother. Did you ever have the Big Brother here? You know what we're talking about? Like people go into a house for 1 week or whatever, a few weeks, and there's camera and you see everything they do. Right? This was the first one that would ever come. And they said it's going to boom the audiences, everybody's going to watch it. So Prigat should be the sponsor. It will involve sex. This is the presentation from the TV station. We go to the client and say, you don't want to be there with Prigat. Natural choice, remember the guy balloon stuff? Why do you want to go? Well, because everybody will see. Our sales will boom. Okay, everybody will see, but it has no connection to your brand. Yeah, but sex is natural. Yeah, don't you recognize the client talking? Sex is natural. Okay, so completely against the will of the agency and against our advice, they went sponsoring this. So we had to do, if it's sex, we had to do these two very, very bad commercials.
Singur, de la mare, față în față cu ispita și trebuie să reziste cu orice preț. Crezi că în stare? Află din vara ispitelor, emisiunea în care cuplurile vin să-și testeze fidelitatea și să caute răspuns la întrebarea a rezista sau a nu rezista ispitei. Urmărește din 15 iulie vara ispitelor, prezentată de Prigat Nectar. Alegerea naturală.
The summer of temptations, the temptation summer, he has to resist the temptation, bullshit like that. Okay? And here's the second one. Even worse.
Singură, la mare, față în față cu ispita și trebuie să reziste cu orice preț. Crezi că în stare? Află din vara ispitelor, emisiunea în care cuplurile vin să-și testeze fidelitatea și să caute răspuns la întrebarea a rezista sau a nu rezista ispitei. Urmărește din 15 iulie vara ispitelor, prezentată de Prigat Nectar. Alegerea naturală.
Because at the same time, the print ads were these. Actually, I really believe this is a good print ad for a Jew. Not an idea, not an award winner, but it's a fair print ad for a Jew. Especially since they were launching the bottle in this shape. You know? This was the new bottle. So I think this was a nice print ad. But when you see this on outdoor and on printed and on posters in the shops, and at the same time on TV, you see the temptation summer, I think you don't know exactly what Prigat is and what does he want with you. To their credit, to the client's credit, their sales boomed that summer because they were sponsoring this. They were very, very visible. The sales went like this. But yearly, we make the brand rep study, okay, and the values of the brand went like this. Yeah, people were buying it, but people were hating it, and then saying, "What's it? It's cheap. It's downgrading. We don't like it," and so on. And it was a lot of work to bring it back from there. Even if we did bad advertising, Nectar was the market leader. It became the market leader. I don't know which one. Ah, ok, adaptation.
Ascultă, reacționează.
Real.
Ignore.
Wow. Mix, which is different mixtures of fruit. They came with this commercial from Israel. We said, why do you come with this one? You just made Varese Peter, okay, the Temptation Summer. You're coming with a commercial with Mediterranean faces. They don't look Romanian, don't look from this market. It's a Romanian brand. Why do you put it on there? Why do you launch Mix now? No, we need to do it, It was a major flop. I mean, the sales... The mix was considered the cheapest Prigat, so it killed Prigat. It killed the Nectar. It was really a major flop. They pulled it off and the product off the shelves in 2 months.
Cum ați schimbat sticlanica de Prigat?
Păi, hai să vedem. În primul rând mai mare.
Da, nu s-au dat chiar.
Așa mai sexy. Și din plastic, să fie ușoară.
Mai bine de sticlă, dar să nu mai fiu.
Aș face o etichetă nouă, albastră.
Da, și cu portocale mari.
Da, albastră, nu?
Corect. Iar ca să ai de înțelege, noua sticlă nereturnabilă de 300 de mililitri. Alegerea naturală de la Prigat.
So this was the launching of the new, what we call it, the small bomb bottle. Like a consumer focus group that talks about the bottle, exactly how they usually do, clients with the packages, you know. Call some people, how do you like the package? So it was a commercial was like this. So this was pretty much what we did like for 4 years on Prigat. I think this is the last one from that part. Miracles happening every day. Take your time to enjoy them all. Prigat natural choice. Actually, this was the last one in Prigat Nectar series, like 1 year and a half ago or something, which actually is the first one that has any connection to the launching commercial. It's the first one that has any connection over 5 years, you know, with the first one. If this was the brand idea, right? The natural choice. Do you think we had any integrity over 5 years, saying the natural choice? I felt we didn't. Charisma, every now and then maybe. I like the last commercial. It's not again an award winner, but it has a good mood to it. I like to print it, but I don't think we talk with any charisma to the guys. Did we build belief in this brand the way we define it? I mean, people buying and loving us. Yeah, people were buying us. People were buying us mostly because the other choice for a long time has been Santal from Parmalat, and they didn't do much communication. Then Coca-Cola came with Capi and not necessarily nice commercials. So the competition was not really tough. And I expect that this thing happens in any emerging market. Sometimes you can sell a lot in an emerging market with bad advertising. But did you build belief? No, I don't think so. Did we build a brand? Again, I don't think so. Luckily, in the same time, they had a problem. 3 years ago, they had a problem in the 0.5 liters plastic bottle, which was their main SKU, their main bottle from the whole range of Prigat. In still drink, they had a problem. They were losing shares with this one. And they said, okay, let's launch a new line extension. With this new packaging, with the new, it was the first one on the market with this, whatever, the cork, the sports cork. Let's launch this this sub brand, and they made it a sports drink. They meaning to the juice, they added some more minerals and vitamins, and this makes it a sports drink, something that you drink immediately after you make an effort, you make sport, in order to rebalance your vitamins and minerals in the body. Okay. Added minerals and vitamins give you extra energy. So we said, okay, the brand with of this line extension is added minerals and vitamins, more minerals and vitamins, then the brand idea for us should be extra energy. And the brand idea, and I'll tell you why we said in everyday situations, because we said if we stick to sports, if it's called a sports drink, and we go like, when you need energy in sports, years from now, Gatorade will come, Powerade will come, all the classical sports coming from Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, and so on will come and will kill us. Because we're a local brand, they will come with the advertising made in the United States and so on, with all their power, and they will kill us. With the tradition, with contracts signed with Kobe Bryant and Michael Jordan, and this is it. How can we fight with Pregat? Okay. Then what we did, we made Pregat. And also because we were trying to save the juice, the 0.5 normal juice, okay, let's do it, extra energy in everyday situations. And luckily enough, the client saw this as a niche, as a tactical product. So they left us to do whatever we wanted to do with it. So this was the launching campaign. We had two commercials. It as a tactical, we didn't have to say anything. We didn't say extra vitamins. It was a launching. You know, we didn't say anything. We just left it there on the screen. I mean, the patch, half empty. The second one was this. Okay, that was broadcasted like 1 month later. We came with this one. She was 90 kilos. She was 70 years old and 90 kilos. It was hard throwing her up. Huh? Okay, and the print campaign that accompanied it was this one called The Stairs. Again, the same thing. I mean, the picture inside the story, half drunk, no headlines, nothing. Talking about respecting the intelligence of the consumer. The second one was this one. People that have too much energy, they try to, you know, build a harder life for themselves. And the third one was this. It never works on big screens. The yellow team has only like one defender, one midfield, and one attacker. Okay, the rest are cut. So he only has like three players. I'd say this time, within Pregat Active, two commercials, three print ads, they all said the same thing. Pretty much in execution as well, the way the product was coming into the story and so on. Charisma, much more than, I would say that it's much more than we had with the first ones. 1 year later, we had this commercial. At the same time as the others. So, and the story was, because this one was a tactical product for them. Out of their budget, 10% would go into Prigat Active and 90% into the other ship that you've seen. So Prigat Active was every now and then, bah, 3 weeks on air, you know. And the ship was like the whole year. This was the second year campaign in print. Okay. This was the boat. And this was the bicycle with the brakes stuck to the whatever you call that. Again, if you look at the product, how the product is put into the story, it's exactly the same thing. No headlines, don't shout to the consumer, let him understand the story in his own head. So if this was the brand idea, Extra-Energy in everyday situations, I think over the 2 years, we showed integrity, and I think we showed a lot of charisma. And just to show you that integrity goes beyond advertising, what I told you earlier, wherever the brand gets in contact with the consumer. I heard somebody told me that in the previous presentation, somebody showed this example. Okay, we partnered with a leading electro retail chain in the country for some unconventional media. I hope she doesn't, or who did it, didn't have this movie also. This was the unconventional media we did. We're actually thinking about using them as print ads as well, because they work very well as print ads. And this one I love best. Huh? So just, you know, comparing when we don't have anything to say and we are all over the place for the same brand, with the same agency, with the same client, and when we have a single brand truth and a single brand idea, very clear, very simple, single-minded, one thing to say, yeah, that we tell with integrity and we tell with charisma. So these are some charts about, this was done last year, advertising unaided awareness. If you look at it, Brigat Active is the second one, right, with 22.8%, which is almost double than Brigat Nectar. And this is part of the fact that, as I told you, the budget was split 90 for Prigat Nectar and 10% for Prigat Active. But this is what people remember. In aided awareness, the figures were the same. Prigat Active had much more advertising aided awareness. When they were asked which commercials do you recall from Prigat, 87, almost 90% of the people said they remember Prigat Active, although it was like 3 weeks per year on air, while Prigat Nectar was very heavily on air, only 60% of the people remember. Let me show you the problem. Okay, if you look at the first one that says May 01, okay, the Prigat is the blue, the bottom blue one. They were head to head in, as I told you, the problem was in 0.5 PET, which is the plastic bottle, okay, 0.5 PET. In 2001, they were head to head. what happened? They lost a lot in 2002. If you look, they went down. Brigatt went down to 31%, while Capi grew from 39 to 48, taking half the market in this specific SKU, in this specific bottle. And this is when we launched as a solution, as a tactical solution, we launched Brigatt Active. In one year's time, Brigatt in 0.5 jumped to 55% and killed Capi. I thought I had another chat here. Okay. I also had a chat, probably. I don't know how I lost it. I also had a chat showing how this small tactical line extension pulled the whole brand up without cannibalizing, but pulling the norm of the average juice very, very, very high. 3 years later, okay, 2005, Brigatt Active is the most awarded, talking now to the people in the agency that love prizes, and this is a creative festival, is the most awarded Romanian brand, much more than Telecom, much more than beers, much more than any other brand, with less money than any other brand. It's the most awarded Romanian brand. Talking about creativity, the stairs, the first one that you see with the hopscotch drawn on stairs, is still the most awarded ever printed in Romania. First Romanian finalist in Epicam, first Romanian finalist in Clio in the United States. Best in our local festival, it won best printed of the year, best outdoor of the year, best poster of the year in 2003. It was a finalist in Porto Rojo only. It didn't win in Porto Rojo. This is our local outdoor, is our Romanian festival. The commercials, Boy and Old Lady, were also finalists in Porto Rojo. Roller Coaster, the one with the kids piggybacking on the parents, won a silver drumstick in Porto Rojo. Here's the silver drumstick. Well, they still had drumsticks in Porto Rojo. Right now they have only drums. Also got the local award. Actually, locally, it's only Brigatt every year. Brigatt. The guys from Coca-Cola, like this. The boat got best print in non-alcoholic beverages and a silver drum in Porto Rojo last year, nominated for best print, best outdoor of the year locally, and got a silver drum in Porto Rojo. The bike, 2 weeks ago, it was a finalist, and the bike with the brakes, it was a finalist at the Clio Awards 2 weeks ago in the United States. The extra energy campaign that we did for Brigatt Active 2003-2004, it was nominated for best campaign of the year locally in Romania. And and it was and it won a Golden Watch in Porto Rojo. If you know the Golden Watch competition in Porto Rojo, right? For the best campaigns in Central and Eastern Europe. So I have a Movado watch at home. This is my colleague, the art director that we work for. Well, just to prove to the two clients in the audience that creativity pays and creative awards do pay in terms of business, in terms of efficiency, Brigatt Active won Effies. The Effie Award, we have Effies in Romania, which is the competition for efficiency, for sales. How much did you sell? How much did you, to what extent did you fulfill your objectives in the brief? It got a silver Effie both last year and this year. We only had two Effies, Effie Awards so far. Brigatt won in both of them. Okay. This is my colleague from the strategy department taking the award. This should have come much sooner. Okay. This is the one that I told you. When we launched the red one, is Brigatt Active. Okay? He built 6% for him, but he pulled the yellow one from... like a locomotive. What happened now? And this is probably the most interesting part of the whole thing. Brigatt Active changed the whole image of Brigatt brand. Okay? In the brand performance, the only personality attributes of the whole Brigatt brand were given by Brigatt Active. So people would remember, what did they think about Brigatt is active, dynamic, energetic, full of vitality. While the whole year, the whole of last year, we had the commercial with the guy looking at the clouds. Not dynamic, not active, not energetic, not full of vitality. But because we had the roller coaster for 3 weeks, this is Frigat, okay? So this, we made this presentation, exactly the same presentation I did for you, I did it for the client a few months ago. Listen, guys, let's look at what we did together in the last 8 years. You gave us free hand, you know, on one thing, and look what, how it's done. And you said, let's do the other business the way you wanted to, and look what, how it performed. What do you think about it? And I don't think that any reasonable people would look at this presentation and say, we would say the same thing. So what happened is the natural choice, which used to be the whole thing of Frigat, is gone. And now the whole idea of the whole brand of Frigat is natural energy. We switched the whole range of Frigat, and the whole budget of Frigat will take the personality of Frigat Active. And this is the campaign. The slogan went away from natural choice, and now the new slogan of the whole brand is more food, more energy. That will say naturalness, but it will say energy. And here's the latest campaign we did for them.
Mai mult fruct, mai multă energie.
Forget the fact.
Prima gamă completă fără conservanți.
Okay, this is one. This was done in April, 1 month ago.
Copilași, hai să vedem acum. Hai, păstru un singur rând, frumos aliniați. Hai, și voi acolo puțin mai în spate. Bun, haide. Frigat. Mai mult fruct, mai multă energie. Prima gamă completă, fără conservanți.
New packagings, and we wanted to show that the whole range was under the same idea. This is why we have this lousy pack shop at the end. Now the pack shop is gone after 1 month. It's only the logo and more food, more energy. And this was the third commercial we did.
Mai multă energie. Prima gamă completă fără conservanți.
And this is the outdoor that is now all over Bucharest for the last month. We're not social, we're not much into preservation of wildlife and stuff. Last week, so I'm festival after festival. On Saturday we had our local award show where I was not in the jury, but I was trying to win last week. Fisherman got the best TV in non-alcoholic beverages. So I think it's the third year in a row where Frigat is taking the category. The Whale was voted best outdoor of the year. And Frigat was finally got best campaign of the year. And this year we had a sponsor, so I got a Seati pizza, a yellow, very nice yellow Seati pizza last Saturday, coming for the best campaign of the year. Of course, Leo Burnett was for the third time agency of the year. Sales are up to full capacity. Since we started this campaign in April, they're looking to buy new lines, new production lines, because they sell everything they have over the new positioning, over the new campaign. So I told you, if you have a brand with brand idea, tell it with charisma, tell it with integrity, probably you'll have a lot of success. Questions? I don't know if I talked talked longer than our time. It was the last one, so who cares? Any questions? Any brand in Ukraine that says one thing only over the last years with integrity and with charisma? See what I mean? But it's your job. It's the same in Romania. It's very few brands that manage to stay consistent. Local brands, of course. I mean, not when they come, Marlboro, this is Marlboro, but local brands, very few brands manage to be consistent and also seduce the people over the past few years. And I tell you, all of them, it's two or three of them, all of them are market leaders. This is for the clients, and all of them get a lot of awards. This is for the ages. Nemirov, was Nemirov? I don't know this one. Was the campaign? What was the campaign? Do you know if it ended the festival? There was no work for the festival. Because everything I know about Ukrainian advertising is what I've seen in the festival. You want to know who won?
Yes.
Yeah. Come to tonight at the gala. So no questions. I made a very clear presentation. Thank you. Then thank you and see you later at the gala. Not a lot of prizes. Sorry, guys.